the other big news is not is of a sad nature. Yeah. The passing on of Morgan Tsvangirai. Yeah. He's really fought for many years for Zimbabwe's liberation from ZANU-PF, because yes, ZANU-PF is still in power for so many years. I think it is one of those countries where one party has remained in power for the longest time. Morgan Tsvangirai really tried to change that. He's gone without having achieved it. He still leaves ZANU-PF in power. Mugabe is out, but it's still ZANU-PF. Yes?
Yeah, I you know, first of all, my prayers and sympathies to the family of Tsvangirai and the people of Zimbabwe. This is a man who has really struggled. And for him to have stood against Robert Mugabe at that time, he is a brave man. And you know, he served as a prime minister. And he was the figure for opposition politics. And he was the guy that was representing change, just like, you know, his party, the party's name.
Yes.
And I know right now with him gone, actually there's going to be some kind of disillusion as pertaining who succeeds him and who can, because, you know, Morgan was such a strong person and a darling of the West. But you remember his power and his movement kind of died a little bit when his wife died in a car crash.
Yes.
Because his wife was like the real figure behind his political success. And now that he's gone, what do we think? Because the president that is there, of course, he may do better than, a little bit better than Mugabe, maybe. I say maybe because he still has a history. He has baggage from his
he's still ZANU-PF.
Yeah, I know, he's still ZANU-PF, and I'm so happy that he and Kenya we did away with,
yes,
with KANU. It's still there, but you know, it cannot be there as ANC in South Africa and ZANU-PF, whereby it is like generational.
Yes.
They just pass on the mantle.
It's like Tanzania's Chama Chama Mapinduzi,
and then they
never seems to go away.
Then they come, they still come. You know, these are like traits, like like, you know, a child is born and they inherit some of the characteristics of the parents. So these parties still come in, and these new leaders are ushered in, like, you know, we are having Cyril in South Africa. But you find that there will be a few things that you know, Zuma had, and they're coming, and Mbeki, and you know. And so in Zimbabwe it is unfortunate, because maybe with the new president there was a little space for the growth of democracy.
Yes.
And there was space because Mugabe was a hardliner. He was that,
yes,
person of the old school,
mm-hmm,
where he just was like, you know, I fought for this country, I am the guy, and nobody else should talk. So it is a sad day for the people of Zimbabwe, but we pray that, you know, God will raise another person.
Mm-hmm. And of course, this changes completely the face of Zimbabwean politics, because following that exit of Robert Mugabe from the helm of that country's leadership, of course, everyone thought that Morgan Tsvangirai should have been the successor. Now Morgan Tsvangirai has passed on. Mnangagwa, who is now the leader, who took over as acting president, still awaiting elections, of course, but now it appears it will still remain within ZANU-PF. Who will succeed Morgan Tsvangirai as opposition leader? It is yet to be seen. Well, that is as far as Zimbabwe politics are concerned. Let's now come back home. Quite a lot is happening here.
And Fred, I just say, I think one of these days we'll get to a position like I'm looking at Prime Minister Bibi Netanyahu.
Yes.
And, you know, the police have said, you know, he should be prosecuted. And I hope that in Africa we get there, where, you know, not only in Kenya, but Africa as a continent.
Yeah, of course, you're talking about a story on page 40 of the Standard. Netanyahu snubs calls to resign. Police want the Prime Minister indicted for bribery, fraud and breach of public trust after investigation. He harshly criticized the investigation against him and said he has no intention of leaving office. This is in Israel.
That is really nice, where, you know, institutions, the institutions there, fight the presidency, you know, like whereby, you know, we will be saying that the president or the prime minister is not above the law. When they get into a breach, when they get on the wrong side of the law,
yes,
action can be taken. They can be investigated, they can be prosecuted, And this kind of immunity in Africa, whereby the rulers in Africa, they just really overshield themselves, and then they do things, and they go even, they just cross the borders in their actions.
Yeah.
So maybe we're going to get there one of these days.
Incidentally, that appears to be, okay, fine, in a very different way, but it appears to be happening in South Africa, that a president, if at all the party, ANC, for example, which is a majority in that parliament, feels that the president is getting out of hand, the party is strong enough to recall him and actually replace him. Okay, of course, it's a different governance system. It's a parliamentary system. In Kenya, we do not have that. We have a very powerful Jubilee Party. The president, because of the system, of course, it cannot do that. But don't you think that probably some of these systems of governance could help rein in on leaders who we feel maybe they're getting out of hand?
Yeah, absolutely. Absolutely. And we were getting there. We were getting there as Kenya as a country. Because I've been, I've been a student of history and government. That's one of my best things. And we were getting there. We had a strong parliament. You remember when we had a speaker, Marende, and during those days we had a very strong parliament. And they even tried to do it under Speaker Muturi in the last parliament. But sometimes when we get to too much, you know, tyrant of numbers.
Yes.
Whereby, you know, people can become roggy and they can do what they want, they can go out of their way. Sometimes we become colorblind.
Yes.
We just become blind to reality and, you know, we want to intimidate, we want to show our might.
Just trying to draw parallels with what's happening in Israel, in South Africa, and back here home in Kenya, of course, we're talking about institutions and the way they're supposed to work. In South Africa, the police actually say the Prime Minister should be indicted for fraud, bribery, and breach of public trust. That's the police working that way in Israel. In South Africa, of course, ANC party recalling its own leader, who is the president, and replacing him. And they're able to do that. Yet you come back home and something different seems to be happening, that we're seeing a trend where the executive appears more and more to be exerting its influence on the legislature. Right now, Parliament, what's happening in Parliament, is determined at State House. Parliamentary group meetings are held at State House, and the President orders this and the other to happen. We are also seeing that the executive is extending its hand to try and change a few things in the judiciary as we speak. We're seeing now the Jubilee Party even writing to the CJ saying that, yes, you are favoring the other side. And we are going to revisit these things. Don't you think that probably where we are heading as Kenya is probably not where these other countries
and,
are?
You know, Fred, you know, apart from being a member of parliament, you know, I'm a bishop.
Yes.
And as a bishop, I have to be very optimistic. I really have to believe in a bright day, even when it's so gloomy and so cloudy and so rainy. I just have to believe it's going to be sunny and beautiful. I think... also, and I'm not wanting to criticize my coalition, but one of the things we are doing that is not very good for us as NASA is walking out of parliament.
Mm-hmm.
Because you see, we should embrace parliament and stay in parliament and stay put in parliament and argue on the floor of the House. Like recently, Mheshimiwa Junet and our minority leader, Mbadi, they were arguing over the issue of withdrawal of security, like even mine was
but
withdrawn.
But inside the House.
But inside the House, on the floor. You see, we derive our power, our legitimacy on the floor of the National Assembly.
Mm-hmm.
So, you know, if we walk out of the chamber, then we leave our colleagues to have a field day. They may even vote to change the Constitution while we are away. And so I'm thinking that we should not despair. And we should not give in, but we ought to stay in parliament, argue in parliament, because like if we didn't like the nominees or we don't agree to the legitimacy or whatever it is, we need to be there and talk to the speaker and say, Mr. Speaker,
exactly.
I don't agree with
you. And those are the same sentiments being shared on Twitter as well. Many people would